We never get beyond our own inadequacy to discover His adequacy. We'll never do anything of lasting value.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of the Spirit, washed in His blood. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And all is at rest. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. Yeah, this. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior. All the day long, and all the day long,
gonna praise my Jesus.
I'm gonna praise
my Jesus.
Let me now read to you from Exodus chapter 4. I'm going to read from verse 10 down to verse 17. And if you have been with us in recent weeks, you'll know that we're looking at this first part of the book of Exodus when God called Moses and sent him back into Egypt to bring the people of Israel, who had gone as honored guests some 400 years before, but now have been reduced to servitude and more than that to slavery and bondage. And they've grown to 2 million. They've tried to keep the population down. They've tried to kill baby boys. Moses escaped that genocide. And when he was 80 years of age, God met with him at the burning bush. And the conversation of the burning bush covers chapter 3 and 4. And I'm coming in during this conversation in verse 10, where God and Moses are talking back and forth, and Moses raising problems and God is giving answers, and Moses sees another problem, God gives another answer, Moses sees another dilemma, and God comes in again with an answer. And we're coming in part of that in verse 10, where Moses said to the Lord, "O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." And the Lord said to him, "Who gave man his mouth? Who makes him deaf or mute? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say." But Moses said, "O Lord, please send someone else to do it." Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, "What about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth, and I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand so that you can perform miraculous signs with it." Then the conversation ends. Next verse says, "Then Moses went back to Jethro, his father-in-law, and began to make the arrangements to go back into Egypt as God had instructed him to." You know, most of us are a lot less confident than we probably look. Behind our outward appearances usually lie inner insecurities, self-doubt, fears. While at the same time, most of us look out at others and we assume them to be confident and self-assured in a way that we ourselves are not. And many of us are desperate to deal with that kind of issue. If you're not sure about that, go into any good bookstore and see how many shelves are devoted to self-help books, to confidence-building tricks that you can learn. See how many seminars come along that will address how you can be the confident you. And you realize when you see the variety of things available how insecure most of us feel. Let me read you an advertisement that I saw only in the last 2 days. And I'll read it you word for word. It says, "Discover how you can boost your confidence through the roof. Eliminate your shyness, burst past old limitations, and instantly program your mind for success." And here's the best bit. "All of this in under 15 minutes. Well, that combines the age-old fears of our lack of confidence and our shyness and our limitations with 21st century superficial, instant, 15-minute solutions. And it is superficial, of course. Perhaps Moses should have taken a course like that. You know, I love the fact that Scripture tells the truth about its heroes. When you look into this scripture, if you ever see somebody who appears on a pedestal, you can be pretty sure at some stage he's going to fall off it anyway. And again and again and again, when you look into the stories of the heroes of scripture, you find yourselves looking into a mirror. And you find that these people were very much like I am. When God called Moses at the burning bush to lead Israel out of Egypt, he had lots of reasons why he could not do it. And many of us here are very slow, if almost completely reticent, to get involved in serving God because we have our reasons, we have our excuses, and more than that, we believe those reasons and we believe those excuses. And so we're glad other people are on the job. But I never could be. You know, there's something refreshingly familiar with Moses' excuses. We're going to look at some of them this morning. But we're not just concerned with a bit of Old Testament history. We are looking into the pages of Scripture to find out God's agenda for us as His people. What is a biblical church? What's it supposed to do? How's it supposed to do it? The New Testament church is primarily two-dimensional. If I may, for simplification, speak of it in that way, it has an upward dimension, it has an outward dimension. Now, it's necessary to be inward-looking from time to time, but usually as a means of course correction, so that our upward and our outward perspectives are wholesome and healthy. The upward look is, of course, to Christ our head. It is that we may love Him with all our hearts and souls and strength, that we may depend on Him, knowing His sufficiency for us, that we may be obedient to Him, submitting to His lordship in our lives. There's an upward look. It is the source of everything else. But there's the outward look. And the outward look is the look of how it is that we are workers, in the words of Paul, workers together with Him in reaching our world. The Church of Jesus Christ is a missional church. That is, its reason for existence is the mission of God, the purposes of God. We have no independent purpose other than the purposes of God. And to be missional is to be more than approving mission or applauding mission or giving money to mission. It's even more than praying for mission. It's to be involved together with God in His mission, locally and globally. But we need to be very honest about this. All of this looks much easier when other people are doing it. And when it comes to me, when it comes to us, most of us are actually scared. Of course we are. And I want to look at Moses' response to God at the burning bush, because the interesting thing is the first words that Moses spoke to God at the bush in Exodus chapter 3 were when God called his name. He said, "Here I am." And then there's lots in between. And the last words that Moses says to God are in chapter 4, verse 13, when he says, "Please send someone else." So I'm putting those two statements together as the title of my message this morning. Here I am, please send someone else. And it probably resonates. Now I want to look at the five excuses that Moses gave to God as to why he should send someone else. And God's answers to those five excuses. And they're very common excuses. The first one, and very understandable excuse. The first one is in chapter 3, verse 10, when Moses says, "I am inadequate." That's the essence of that. Because when the Lord said, "I'm sending you," Moses said, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" Now we can speculate about the legitimate reasons why Moses thought this at this stage when God spoke to him. But there had been a time when Moses had actually believed in his own significance, he'd believed in his own influence, and he'd believed in his own ability. We know that because in Acts chapter 7, when Stephen gave that address to the Sanhedrin council, and he surveyed the whole Old Testament story. If you want the Old Testament in a nutshell, read Stephen's sermon in Acts chapter 7. And one of the things he says there in Acts 7:42 is that Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. And by the way, Egypt was the most civilized, advanced country in the world. And Moses, by virtue of the fact he'd been adopted into the royal family, humanly through a fluke, when he'd been hidden to avoid being killed as a baby in a basket in the river Nile, and Pharaoh's daughter had found it, taken him home, adopted him, and therefore he'd been educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, one of the best educated people there would have been. His royal privileges would have given him access to the best teachers. Not only that, says Stephen, he was powerful in speech, an orator, a persuader of men, and powerful in action. And then verse 25 says that Moses thought, this was when he was 40 years of age, Moses thought that his own people would realize that God was using him to rescue them, but they did not. In other words, at the age of 40, Moses came to a conclusion that nobody else actually shared. And the conclusion was, I am the kiddie. I'm the guy. I'm the man. Why don't they realize that with all my education and the wisdom of Egypt, in all my contact with Egyptian hierarchy, with the fact that I'm powerful in speech and powerful in action, I'm one of the few men who can make things happen. Why don't they realize that I've been planted by God in the right place at the right time to be the means of rescuing them? But it says they did not. In other words, the people were totally unimpressed. The only person who believed in Moses at that stage seemed to be Moses himself. And in his own strength, based on his own competence and his own self-belief, Moses had tried to do something about the predicament of Israel, and he had killed an Egyptian. Whether his strategy was to get them all one by one, I don't know, but he got one certainly, buried him in the sand a little too quickly because somebody found the body, and Moses was accused of his murder and fled from Egypt into the Midian desert. And for the next 40 years, having found some girls looking after sheep, he got a job with them, worked for their father as a shepherd, married one of them, and lived in the backside of the desert for these next 40 years. Every year, more and more drained of his self-confidence and drained of his own significance. And now when he's 80 years of age, God appears to him. I've heard the cry of the people. I've seen their distress. I've come down to rescue them. I am sending you. Who am I? And God's answer to Moses' inadequacy was in the next verse. I will be with you. You may be insignificant, Moses, you may be inadequate to the task, Moses, but I am not. And the Lord's reaction was not to make Moses adequate or somehow transform him into a man up to the task by his own right. What he did promise him was the adequacy of his own presence in the inadequacy of Moses' self-sufficiency. And that, of course, is an eternal truth. If we never get beyond our own inadequacy to discover his adequacy, we'll never do anything of lasting value. We can try to muster up courage or try to generate skill on our own. Of course we need skill, of course we need courage, but all of that devoid of spiritual content, which is the presence and life of God himself, active within us, will come to nothing. And the secret of effective service is that it is on the basis of divine adequacy expressed through human inadequacy that produces fruit. So what do you have to be to qualify, adequate or inadequate? The answer is you have to be inadequate. At the age of 40, Moses would classify himself adequate. Best education, influence, powerful speech, young man, fit, ideal, why don't the people recognize it? Because there had to come a point when Moses would come to the conclusion he was inadequate. And that's when you discover divine adequacy is expressed through human inadequacy. Henrietta Mears, who wrote a book, Every Man a Bible Student, says, and whether she originated this, I don't know, because I've seen this in various forms, but she said that Moses' life can be divided into three 40-year periods. The first 40 years, Moses thought he was somebody. The next 40 years, he discovered he was nobody. And the last 40 years, he discovered what God can do through a self-confessed nobody. And that is the best summary I know of Moses' life. And it contains some of the most profound truths of the Christian life. Discovering that in ourselves we can do nothing and we are nothing in ourselves, as the New Testament so repeatedly tells us. But that in Christ, in his indwelling presence, we discover what God does with somebody who in themselves is inadequate. And I ask you, have you discovered, really discovered, not as a doctrine, not as a theory, not as a pointer, have you discovered through your tears and your back up against the wall and you have no idea where to go, have you discovered your inadequacy? You're on the right track if you have. Provided you go beyond that now to discover the adequacy of God and the inadequacy of your own life. That's the first thing that Moses didn't know. And his first excuse, I'm inadequate. His second excuse was, okay, but I'm ignorant. Because in chapter 3, Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? I don't know what to say. I mean, if I go and they ask me a question, I'm stuck. How can I talk about God's purpose when I don't even know your name? And I don't know how to answer their questions. Does that ring a bell, by the way, with anybody here this morning? Why are you so reticent to talk about Christ? Is it because you don't know what to say? I think for many of us, it is. We certainly haven't got all the answers, that's for sure. But do we have to? I mean, Moses was to go and tell the people what he knew, not what he didn't know. But of course, this question, what is your name, is a very important question, because asking what is your name is more than asking what is the label we can put on you to identify you. Names meant something. And God answers with a name that has incredible significance to the conversation. He says there in verse 14, chapter 3, God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. Now, we talked about this name a couple of weeks ago as well. But I am in the present tense, Moses. Everything you'll ever need in any situation. A man called Alec Motyer, who has written a number of Old Testament commentaries in particular, has a commentary on Exodus, and he says about this statement, this name, I am that I am, he says it is an open-ended assertion of divine sufficiency. When I read that, I thought about that, open-ended, I like that. It doesn't close down the barriers of God's sufficiency, it is open-ended, because in whatever situation you are in, whatever circumstances arise, I am sufficient. Whatever unexpected hump on the road you face, I am. Whatever comes in from left field and catches you totally by surprise, I am sufficient. It is open-ended. And there always remains an abundance yet to be explored and yet to be experienced in God himself. That's where the Christian life is a continuous adventure. If you live it this way, because whatever you know of God today, whatever you experience with God up until now, don't settle down and plateau and say, well, that's it. We go on growing. As we go on seeing and experiencing God, no situation, he can say to Moses, in fact, no situation will ever catch me out. No situation will ever find me inadequate or insufficient. I am. It is, of course, where we get the name Jehovah. Probably more accurately, Yahweh would be the Hebrew pronunciation of that. And of course, this remains true for us today. We live the Christian life under the umbrella of what Paul calls the unsearchable riches of Christ. You can search them, but you'll never reach the borders. It's like the universe. You go on exploring it. Where's the end of it? Where's the wall that says that's the end of the universe? And if there is a wall, what's beyond that wall anyway? And the unsearchable riches of Christ. This is what you and I are to live every day under the protection of the fact that there are unsearchable riches. You've never had reason to discover some of them yet, but now you're in a situation. Now the lights have gone out in your life. Now you don't know where you are. Now you're confused. There's something new about God to discover in this. And if we're going to get anywhere in serving God and living the Christian life, we have to believe this. Our sufficiency is in him, as Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 5. Let me read you what he said there. Not that we are competent in ourselves to claim anything for ourselves, but our competence is from God. The King James says our sufficiency is of God. That is, what we need, where do we get it from? It is of God. And in 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 8, Paul says there that our God is able to make all grace abound to you so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Look at the superlatives in that verse. He'll make all grace abound to you so that in all things, at all times, you'll have all that you need and you'll abound, not just get by, in every good work. All of this is just a fleshing out in some way what it means for God to be I am. So where's the deficiency when there's deficiency? It's certainly not in God. And therefore, the measure to which we align our lives with his and our wills with his and our mind with his and our hearts with his and we live in submission to him, we won't have everything. But we will have what we need at the time that we need it, all that we need. Moses, you don't know what to say? I am. Any questions? Because Moses, that's enough. And your trust is in me, not in your speaking ability. But the third thing Moses said, I'm inadequate. I'm ignorant. Third thing is I'm impotent. Because in chapter 4, verse 1, Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say the Lord didn't appear to you? What if they doubt me? I mean, after all, this is a huge thing, isn't it? Moses has been missing for 40 years. His reputation probably is still there. It's probably part of the mythology and the story now that Israel has, and the parents tell their kids at night about this baby who was rescued, brought up in the palace, and everything was fantastic, but he disappeared out in the desert, you know, 40 years ago. I've never seen him since. And suddenly, 40 years later, as a man of 80, he rolls into their lives again, walks back into their lives, and says, God appeared to me, and they're probably thinking he's nuts. That's what Moses says. Moses, what have you been eating at in that desert? They simply won't believe me. Do you know why some of us never get involved in serving God? For that very reason, no one's going to believe me anyway. If I talk to my neighbors, they're not going to believe me. In God gives Moses in response to this three signs, which we won't talk about. They turned the staff into a snake. We did talk about that a couple weeks ago. Put your hand into the cloak, it comes out leprous, put it back in. Bring it out again, it's clean. Leprosy was considered incurable in Egypt. This is the sign of the impossible being done. And then take some water, throw it on the ground, and it will turn to blood. We won't talk about those signs because we haven't time to, basically, other than to point out that they are signs. In verse 8, the Lord said, "If they do not believe you or pay attention to the first miraculous sign, they may believe the second." Now, a sign is not a magician's trick. It's not as though he's saying, "Hey, listen, you want to impress them? Go and do this, and boom, man, they'll be impressed. Just put your hand in there, bring it out. Like, yeah. Wow, they'll be impressed. They'll applaud you." No, no, no. That's what conjurers do. That's what illusionists do. I mean, Egypt had them. They had their magicians. They turned staffs into snakes. And the only problem was that Moses' snake ate their snakes. So they had nothing left at the end of it. They turned water to blood. I mean, they could do some of these things. I mean, it's amazing what some of these illusionists, let's give them the honor of being illusionists. If they were magicians by demonic powers, well, they could do things too. I was in Manila many years ago, well, a few years ago, and I was with some missionaries, and we saw that David Copperfield was going to be in Manila doing a show. David Copperfield, one of the most brilliant illusionists around these days, so we went to his show. It was incredible what he could do. It was all illusions, of course, but you could be very impressive. This isn't doing, you know, a magic show. These are signs. This is going to be a sign that points to God, that points to his ability, that points to his enabling, that points to his victory, that points to his competence to do the impossible in the situation. Moses, you're impotent. Okay, you go to work, throw your staff down. What happens? It turns to a snake. Who did that, Moses? Did you do that? No. Who did that? Well, you did that, God. Okay? So I'm impotent, so what? But this is now the power of God in the impotence of Moses. And then the fourth is I'm incompetent. You know, I don't have the right gifts. Look at verse 10 of chapter 4. Moses said to the Lord, "Oh Lord, I've never been eloquent," which actually, pardon me, that isn't true, but that's what he said. Because we're told he was powerful in speech, but that's what he says. "Oh Lord, I've never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you've spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." You know, we can build these kind of pictures of ourselves. I think it's incredible that Moses should say, "I am slow of speech," because his excuses come pretty thick and fast in these two chapters. He's not Hannah answering, "Well, I'll just think of something to say, God. Okay, I've thought about it. Yeah, I've got something to say." It's bang, 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 bang. He can speak fast, all right, don't worry. But that's when God tells Moses that you're to explain what I give you to talk about. God didn't tell Moses to go and explain the things he didn't know about God, but to explain what he did know, however limited that might seem to be. Explain what you do know. And by the way, when you and I engage in conversation with other people, never, never, never be afraid to say, "I don't actually know the answer to that." They'll probably respect you an awful lot more than if you bluff an answer that actually doesn't ring true. I get a lot of emails, and I had an email from somebody who asked me about something. I wrote back and said, "I've got a simple answer to your question. I don't know." So he emailed back and said, "But you're supposed to know. You're the pastor." Back says, "I'm sorry, I don't know. Maybe in a year's time I might know, but I don't know right now. But I'll tell you what, you try and find the answer and then send me the answer back when you found it." Because you have as much access as I do to understanding what does the scripture say. You think about it. It's a concern that you have. It's not actually, it doesn't bug me, this one. So you work it out. But I don't know the answer myself. I'm not going to spend hours working on it for you. You spend hours working on it, and let me know the next time somebody asks me the same question, I'll tell them what you said. But the point is this, you see, We don't know everything. And we get scared because of what we don't know, rather than taking what we do know. I will give you what to say. He said in verse 11, who gave man his mouth? Then in verse 12, now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. Moses, notice here, Moses talks about his ability. I am slow of speech. I have never been eloquent. And God ignores his ability and talks about the substance of what he's going to speak. I'll give you what to say. See, sometimes we get more taken up with someone's speaking ability than we do with the substance of what they have to say. And I tell you, I'd rather listen to somebody who's talking substance, who doesn't maybe have a very good ability to speak well, than someone who can speak well and has little to say. Don't be deceived by the orator. And Moses says, I can't speak. I'm not an orator. I'm not eloquent. And God says, okay. You don't have to be. I'll give you the truth that you speak. And however falteringly you may feel you speak it, it's the truth, not the speaker, that sets people free. God's answers are getting pretty predictable, aren't they? There's everything Moses raises about his own needs, God answers by talking about his own sufficiency in that area. I will take responsibility for this. I will do this. I will do that. I will do the other. Remember that. God's answer to your insufficiencies are always his sufficiency. No matter how you come at these questions, we're going around in circles a bit because God is saying the same thing again and again and again. And Moses is saying the same thing. Moses is saying, I can't. And all these objections, and God is saying in response to all of them, I can. And you know something? If you know those two things, you can live effectively for God. If you know, I can't, he can. Now, of course, there are gifts that God gives to people. There are abilities that he gives to some, and he uses those abilities. We don't just say, well, I have no ability to do certain things, but I'm going to go and do it anyway. You do what God calls you to do, and gifting, spiritual gifting, is part of God's means of fulfilling that through you. But the energy and the power and the authority and the cutting edge that comes through it doesn't come from you. Preachers don't have authority. If they preach with authority, it's because they're preaching truth that God confirms in the heart that this is true. And the last objection Moses had, I'm inadequate. I'm impotent. I'm ignorant. I'm incompetent. Last one, number 5. I'm irrelevant. Because he says in verse 13, Moses said, oh Lord, please send someone else to do it. I'm actually irrelevant here. It's more than that, of course, is I don't actually want to do it. I'm very sympathetic to Moses' response here. And I'll tell you why. I have a theory based on experience, and therefore it's suspect, but I have a theory that very often, certainly in Christian living and Christian service, the best people to do a task or to do some tasks are people who don't actually want to do them. They're often the best people to do them because they are less likely to have their own agenda, less likely to be interested in who gets credit, if anybody gets credit. They probably prefer to be out of sight than to be prominent. Often it's when God says, I have selected you and I'm sending you and I'm giving you this. There must be somebody else. They're often the best people for the job. I get resumes from people writing, seeing if there's some possibility of some position going here at the People's Church. And man, they tell me the most fantastic things about themselves. And I don't go beyond opening it, reading it, and it ends up being filed in my bin. I don't want somebody like that working here. Who says, I am the answer to this need you've got. Man, I am just the bee's knees. But that's what some resumes say, but never before God. When you present your resume to God, God, here I am, warts and all. All the issues of my life that disqualify me. And God comes back with his answer, you can't, I can. God responds to Moses by saying, send somebody else. By being cross with him, it says, Lord's anger burned against Moses. Moses, you know, every time I say something, you're back with another objection to it. But he says, all right, what about your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know he can speak well. He's already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I'll help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He'll speak to the people for you. It'll be as though he were your mouth, as if you were God to him. You know, let's be realistic. Sometimes we need an Aaron, somebody to go around with us. The first time I got involved in trying to witness when I was young, going into coffee bars in England, which was the place where young people hung out in those days, I am so very grateful that I had some errands to go with. And I'd say, you know, because I didn't know how to talk to people, and I was a little bit tongue-tied anyway. I'll come with you, you do the talking, and I'll grunt at the right place and say, yeah, it's true. But you do the talking. And I'm so glad I had some people who did that. And sometimes I learned more than the person they learned. I remember once going to a coffee bar with a guy, his name was Frank. It was his personality as well as his name. He's very frank. And we were talking to a young guy about 16, 17, who was very interested in what we were saying. And my friend said to this young man, can you think of any good reason why you shouldn't become a Christian tonight? And the man thought for a moment and said, no, I can't. And I started thinking, hallelujah, this is fantastic. And Frank said, all right, let me give you some. If you become a Christian tonight, Jesus Christ will become Lord of your life. That means that you'll ask about your future, not what do I want, but what does God want me to do? You won't marry the first pretty girl that says yes to you. You'll say, Lord, who do you want me to marry, if you want me to marry? I give that part of my life to you. And he gave a whole list of things. You know, your money, I don't know if you got much money, but it's not yours anymore if you give your life to Christ tonight. It's going to be his. And I saw this guy begin to shrink in his seat. And I began to shrink in mine. And then Frank leaned across and said, can you still not think of any reason why you shouldn't become a Christian tonight? And the guy said, well, I can think of some now. So Frank said, all right, don't become a Christian until you're ready to surrender all these things to Christ. We left, we got out in the street, and I was angry with Frank. I said, Frank, that guy was so close, and you've scared him away. He said, what did Jesus do? I said, forget about what Jesus did. What did you do I'm concerned about? No, he said. We went and we sat down, and with his New Testament, he showed me how the times, like the rich young ruler, Jesus sent away with nothing. I said, what if this guy walks in front of a bus on his way home tonight? I mean, you missed the opportunity. He said, no, it wouldn't have been a real conversion. That would have been a superficial come into my heart to make my life good type. That's not real conversion. You trust God with the time it'll take for God to draw him to himself. What about these people who walked no more with him? And Jesus said to himself, do you also want to leave? You can leave as well if you like. I mean, that doesn't sound like a very good evangelistic tactic, does it? I'm going to give the invitation. Now, the invitation is go out to the back door if you want to stay. Off you go. Huh? I'm sidetracking there because the point is, it's good to have an Aaron sometimes. And actually, Moses and Aaron become linked together for the rest of Moses, almost the rest of Moses' life. Aaron died a couple of years earlier than Moses in the wilderness. But Moses and Aaron did this, and Moses and Aaron did that, and Moses and Aaron went here, Moses and Aaron went there. And of course, that's not plan B. Jesus sent out his disciples two by two. We give encouragement to each other. We give courage to each other. And sometimes, you know, in this kind of going and talking to people, which is Moses is to do, you know, when one starts talking, you know, it kind of primes the pump and the other then starts talking. But the basic principle lies behind all this is when we realize we can't do it, we discover that if we're going to do anything of any lasting value, the strength is going to be in God. It's going to be His strength, His sufficiency, His working in us and through us. And you know, that doesn't mean everything's going to go smoothly. We've got to resist this temptation to always want to measure what God is doing. What happened in Egypt was the things got worse before they got better. Moses went to Egypt, had a disastrous conversation with Pharaoh, ended up with the door slammed in his face, being sent out, "I will not let these people go." Nothing was accomplished. And worse, he then sent orders down to the slave drivers, "These men who are making bricks, building the city of Ramesses, you make them build bricks without straw." Now, straw is what holds the brick together. And so then the Israelites say, "How come we have to make bricks without straw? This is almost impossible. You put anything on this brick, it'll crumble. What's the reason for this?" Well, it's because of Moses. "Moses, you're making things worse for us. Get back to the desert." You know, don't try to measure success the way we do humanly. And even his leading was confusing, because chapter 14 says a Pharaoh thing. The Israelites are wandering around the land in confusion, hemmed in by the desert. This is not the 40 years wandering when they were going to be out wandering out of their disobedience. This is now, they're not going in a straight line. They look, you know, the whole lot of them look as though they're drunk. They're kind of swaggering and swaying, and they're not going in the same direction. Why? I'll tell you why. They weren't following a plan. They weren't following a roadmap. They're following a pillar of cloud by day, which is God Himself, and a pillar of fire at night. They're not following a plan. They're following God. And God takes detours sometimes, and we don't quite know why. The quickest way from A to B is a straight line, but this has gone all around here and back up again. Why? I don't know, but we're just following God. It doesn't always work out in ways that look good and feel good. We have to trust God and go on trusting God. And God did bring about His purpose. He did take the people to the land flowing with milk and honey. Moses didn't arrive there himself. He died before they got there. There were all kinds of obstacles on the way. There were all kinds of things that went wrong. There was all kinds of disobedience on the way as well. But the point is that when Moses, at the end of this conversation, had all his questions responded to by the same answer, "I will be with you. I am who I am. I will give you what to say. I will perform signs to the people in front of you." Moses, it's your dependence on me that is the key to everything happening. And you won't take credit for it. As Jesus said, "They'll see your good works, but they'll praise your Father who is in heaven." Why praise Him for your good works? Because the origin of your activity is God Himself. And the divine adequacy played out through the human inadequacy, the divine sufficiency played out through the human insufficiency, the divine truth played out through human frailty is what makes the Christian life dynamic and effective and fruitful. And as a missional church, which is only that, is it's full of missional people. It's not just the task that is our preoccupation. It's the source of that task. The presence, the life, the enabling, the spirit, the power of God Himself working in us, working through us. And maybe this morning you've looked into this scripture and looked into a mirror and you say, "You know, I've been stunted for years. I've been sitting back for years. I love the idea that people are getting involved in serving God. And I would love to do it myself. But who am I? I don't know what to say. Oh, Lord, please send other people." You're actually in very good company. But there are answers to every one of those reasons. Will you take those answers to heart and say, "God, use even me? Me?" And He will.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message. And follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Have you ever felt inadequate for a task that someone wants you to do? Maybe you've been asked to bring a potluck dish, but your cooking skills aren't great. Your church wants you to teach Sunday school, but you don't like kids. Your boss asks you to do a presentation when you know you're not good at public speaking. Or God may call you to do something you don't like to do, something you don't feel you're good at. And you're not alone. The Bible is full of stories of people given tasks by God, tasks they didn't feel equipped to do. God asked Moses to go to Pharaoh to bring the Israelites out of Egypt. And Moses' response? Who am I? Moses felt inadequate.
The best people to do a task are people who don't actually want to do it, because they are less likely to have their own agenda.
This story sets the scene for a new series from Bible teacher Charles Price. It's called Here I Am, Send Someone Else. You might think you're not equipped to do God's work. You might even be unwilling. But here's the good news: God can still use you. This new series of messages from Exodus will explain how you can experience God working through you. This series will help you overcome your fear and unlock your hidden potential. You can do what God wants you to do because it is He who will do it through you.
Write to Living Truth to order by mail. Or call Canada, +1 416 222 3341, extension 113. Or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca.
Your presence, Your glory, You're welcome here, and all honor, dominion, Lord, please come near, we want You, we need You. Your name, Your name, Your presence, Your glory, Your welcome here, and all honor dominion. Lord, please come near. We want You. We need You. We live to glorify Your name. Oh, Your glory,
You're welcome here. And all honor and dominion. Lord, please come near. We want you. We need you. We live to glorify your name. Glorify your name. Glorify your name. Your glory, you're welcome here. Lord, you're welcome here. Lord, you're welcome here.